So real quick, I want to start off, if you're taking notes, there's going to be a lot of information. So the pastor always likes to say that this is a teaching church. So I'm going to do my best through the power of the Holy Spirit to teach you a little bit about not just the Word of God, but the significance that we have in this country to be able to read the Word of God. Amen? Amen. So, we're coming up, it's voting season, and there's all kinds of stuff going around. And so we are going to dive into a little bit of a, if you will, a theological and political science class today on the country and the Word of God and how the two correlate and impact one another. Amen? Amen. So the title of the message is called On Earth as It Is in Heaven. So we often hear and we often read in the scriptures that the Bible says that we are already seated with Christ in heavenly realms. So how many of us are currently sitting in heaven? Right? But we're still here on earth, right? So, if you will, what happens in our natural physical world that we see, feel, hear, taste, and touch with our five senses, right, is a reflection and, if you will, the aftershock or the shockwave from something that has already taken place or been established in heavenly realms with Christ. Okay? So what we see is not, it is our reality, but it is a reflection of the reality of the Spirit that has already happened. And so, Matthew chapter 6, if you have your Bibles, turn with me there. Starting in verse 9, we should all know this, this is the Lord's Prayer. Of all of the things that the disciples could have asked Jesus to teach them, right? They spent 3.5 years with him. Of all the things, they didn't ask him, teach us how to cast out demons, teach us how to be more spiritual. They said, teach us how to pray. Matthew chapter 6, it says, in this manner therefore pray, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Using the Holy Ghost.
Now, I didn't give my wife this one, so I'm going to just look it up and read it for you guys real quick. It is, if you have your Bibles, it is Ephesians chapter 2. It's verse 6 and 7. It says, and he raised us up together with him and made us sit down together in the heavenly sphere in Christ Jesus. He did this that he might clearly demonstrate through the ages to come the immeasurable riches of his free grace in kindness and goodness of heart toward us in Christ Jesus. So as I just said, we are already seated in Christ in heavenly realms, but we still have to exist and live here on this earth. And as such, if you've ever read or studied Genesis, God created in 6 days, and then the seventh day he rested. He created this earth for us. And if you read Genesis chapter 1 and in chapter 2, it says he commanded them to have dominion. The word dominion in the Hebrew means to rule and to have authority over something. So, Matthew chapter 6, verse 10. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So I want to focus on that word kingdom first. Okay, so here's going to be our first little bit of taking notes. How many of us, we think of the word kingdom as like the physical place where we sit with God in heaven, right? That's the kingdom. That is a correct thinking about the word, but I want to break down what the word means in Greek. The word in Greek is pronounced basileia. And it's most commonly used in Matthew chapter 6 and throughout that entire little prayer right there, because it's that word kingdom is used several times. The most commonly used meaning in the Bible isn't a physical place, but it means royal power. It is the kingship, it is the dominion, and it is to rule. Not to be confused with an actual kingdom, but rather the right and the authority to rule over a kingdom. So it is the authority to rule over a kingdom. So we are asking God to rule over a kingdom here on earth, as it is in heaven. He rules in heaven, he should rule here on earth. Amen? 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 He doesn't just stop at heaven. He created us in these bodies to live here on earth. So now we have to understand, okay, well, if he's supposed to rule here on earth as it is in heaven, how does that come about? As believers, we should be heavenly minded and focused on Christ and eternity. We trust in God and depend on Him. We do not trust in man's governments, courts, or the systems of man. However, we should be active and influential in those systems. For far too long, we have had this misconception, which the devil, how many of y'all know the devil is slick? He's sneaky, right? But he is not all wise and he is not all powerful. For far too long, the devil has gotten us to think about this idea that there is a separation of the church and the state, and that the church should not be involved in what happens in the world. That we just come to church, we sing hallelujah, we read our Bible, and that we let the world do what the world does, and we just focus on our spirituality. That is a huge lie from the pit of hell. God never intended us for us to take a step back and ignore the chaos of the world. He wanted us to be world changers and influencers for the kingdom. We all hear that term, social influencers, right? People that, you know, they make videos on Instagram and TikTok and whatnot and what have you, right? Social influencers. We should be social influencers for the kingdom of God and for Jesus Christ. The Bible says to speak boldly about the name of Jesus, not to be timid, not to be shy, and not to be quiet about it. Now, that doesn't mean that we go around and we start beating people up with scripture. But the Bible says that the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and intentions and attitudes of the heart. The Bible says that the Word of God is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. Hosea chapter 4, verse 6 says, and here's a homework assignment. Go read Hosea chapter 4. And as you read Hosea chapter 4, I want you to think about what we see going on in the world outside the church around us today, and see if we can make any correlations and comparisons and see some overlaps. And this is what God says to the prophet in Hosea chapter 4, verse 6. It says that, I'll abbreviate it. It says that my people perish for a lack of knowledge. So we have to not only understand the word, because the word is the absolute truth and is the final authority, but we have to understand what God wants us to do with the word. He doesn't want us to just sit here in our little Christian bubble, go home, and not talk about the Word. He has given us mandates in the Word. He has given us a code of morals and ethics that we are to influence the world for Him by using His Word. Amen? Amen. So, When we read the Bible, I want us to understand a couple of things. Number one, I have the authority and the mandate from heaven to implement heavenly policy. I am a citizen of heaven and a child of the King. This is what gives me that authority to implement, promote, and encourage the will of the King and his policies and ideas from heaven here on earth. Earth reflects heaven. Number one, if you're taking notes, write these down, because these are going to be crucial in our thinking, especially as we think about how we are impacted and how we impact and influence the world around us. God didn't want us to be completely separate. He separated us from the world so that we would not be constrained and bound by the world, but he wanted us to live in the world to influence the world for him, because that is the only way that we get the world who is lost inside this building so they can meet Jesus. If we don't go out there to reach them, they won't ever come in here to meet him.
That's a good word, preacher.
So number one, I am a citizen of heaven. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. But we are different because our citizenship is in heaven, and from there we eagerly await the coming of the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Number two, I am a child of the King. John chapter 1, verse 12. But to as many as did receive and welcome him, he gave the right, the authority, the privilege to become children of God. That is to those who believe in, adhere to, trust in, and rely on his name. We sang a song about that this morning. Number three, I have been given the mandate to rule. Genesis chapter 1, verse 28. And God blessed them, granting them certain authority, and said to them, be fruitful, multiply, and fill the earth, and subjugate it, putting it under your power, and rule over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and every living thing that moves upon the earth. There is an idea. I was listening to another pastor. I was listening to a couple different sermons this week. And, you know, yes, you're not the only one. Sometimes I do deep dives on the internet to gather all kinds of information from all over the place to see what people are saying. But you still number one. You still the first pastor, okay? All right. But I was listening to him, and he was giving a teaching on Genesis. And he said something about the book of Genesis chapter 1 that I'd never really ever heard preached before. And I was like, wow, I have never considered that. And then it flowed perfectly into here. He said that when God rested on the seventh day, God rested from his work. But then he gave Adam and Eve the job to continue the work. So God rested, and then he expected us to continue with what he had already started. Like, he stopped and he's like, I'm going to rest. Because here's the crazy thing. How many of us know that we don't create anything according to the scripture? Right? Because the word for create in Hebrew is ex nihilo, which means out of nothing. So that means there is literally nothing that exists, and then God said something, and all of a sudden there was stuff that existed. We can't create anything because we have to have something in order to make something. Like these beams. These beams were not created. They were made out of the wood that God had already made and created out of nothing, right? So God intended for us to not improve upon, but to take what he had created out of nothing and to make stuff to continue to show his glory in what he had already created. Like, we're getting ready to come into the cold season. How many of us are glad for wool mittens? Right? And a nice warm coat. God didn't make wool mittens and he didn't make warm coats. He created sheep so that we could take the wool from the sheep and make the mittens to stay warm when it gets cold. Amen?
Amen.
All right. So that being said, I want us to keep that in our minds as we continue on. So it is not enough for me to just read my Bible, to have my devotions, go to church, and stay in my little bubble. We do not worry when the world is going crazy because we know that God is the final and ultimate authority and that he is in control. We know and we trust God because he is in control. While we are spiritually and heavenly minded, we are still physically and earthly existing. We are in this world, but not of this world. We still have to live, work, and socialize with the world and the people in the world that we live with.
Yes.
Perhaps the world is going crazy because we as Christians have withdrawn from the world and are not exercising our authority and performing our heavenly civic duty. So when we look outside and we look at the world and we're like, man, I can't believe these people. Now, I want us to, I'm going to make a bold statement. Let your theology, and we're going to unpack this statement here. But let your theology influence your politics. The word politics has gotten a dirty rap. But we're going to discuss what it means here in a little bit. But when we look outside and we look at the world and how the world is going crazy and we go, man, it's crazy out there. Glory to God. I'm going to keep going to church. Perhaps the world is going crazy because we sit back and we watch the world as opposed to being in the middle of the world saying, hold on, this is what the Word of God says. This is what the Bible says. This is what Jesus says. Now, this isn't an idea to go and, again, go and beat people up with theology and go and beat people up with scripture, but this is to stop and be able to have a loving, peaceful, and encouraging conversation about what the Word of God says about how we are to live. Amen? So we are citizens of heaven first and citizens of earth second. We have a duty to perform in each place. So we have a duty in heaven, right? To worship God, spend time with him, have a relationship with him, love him, accept his guidance and his deliverance and his salvation, and to perform works for the kingdom. That's a duty that we have. And in such, we also have a duty as citizens of earth. It's not about your country that you live in, although it is about our country right now. It's not about either side, left, right. That's not what it is about. It is about what does the Word of God say to me about how I am to live out there today. So as a citizen of heaven and child of God, it is my duty to bring heaven to earth. We often hear the phrase, the separation of church and state. We think this means that the two should not ever intersect or have conversations with one another. While it is true that we are not a theocracy, anybody know what a theocracy is? All right. If you don't know what a theocracy is, it means that there is the system of government and rule and control over a particular area, country, or region is run by a church or by a specific religious authority. So we are not a theocracy because we do not have a state-sanctioned religion, as there is one religion in the country, and that is the only religion, and everybody must be a part of that religion. That's basically what a theocracy is. One country that I can think of right off the top of my head that is a theocracy would be the country of Iran. The prime minister and ruler of Iran is also an imam in the Islam faith, right? So he is a priest, but he is also, basically, if you will, he's the high priest and he's also the president at the same time. And in Iran, you can only be a Muslim. If you are any other religion other than Islam, you can be killed or imprisoned or jailed or excommunicated and kicked out. So we are not that, right? But we are a country that has been founded on Christian principles, ideals, morals, and values. In the Declaration of Independence, God is mentioned 4 times. And the last paragraph of the Declaration of Independence, if you really read it, reads as a prayer. When you read it, it says, we appeal to the supreme judge of the universe. The Bible says that Jesus will judge the world. So we appeal to the supreme judge, Jesus Christ. That is what they are saying. Here's just a couple quick facts about our country. 9 out of the 13 original colonies required you to be a Bible-believing, church-attending Christian if you wanted to serve in public office. Now, some of those laws were changed and altered, but at the outset, each state had its own constitution. 9 of those 13 required you to be a Christian or to have some sort of Christian belief. All 13 required a statement of faith. So we are not just some random collection of people and states that have just come together and just all of a sudden we form this country. Leviticus is the most quoted book at the original outset of the writing of the Declaration of Independence and our U.S. Constitution. And if you read the book of Leviticus, what is it about? The law. So, one of the reasons why we see so much chaos in our country today, now this is not my statement, I got this from another person, but as I was doing my own research, I was like, wow, he is 100% correct. So the person that I heard say this first was Charlie Kirk. But he made an incredible statement. He said, we are a country that is founded on Christian principles, but we have a society that is increasingly anti-Christian and anti-God. That is why there is such a conflict and we see such division in our country. Because we have a system that was set up to be under God's authority, but our society has ignored God. And so the two are in constant conflict. Because light cannot be present with darkness. So, the idea of separation of church and state. Can you put the First Amendment up there, please? The First Amendment of the United States, it's the first thing they wrote down. The first thing. That means it is the most important thing that we should know as a country and as a people under God's authority. It says, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion. So that means Congress can't say Christianity or Catholicism or Islam is the only religion allowed in this country. But it also means that they cannot make any law prohibiting the establishment of a religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press or the right of the people peaceably to assemble. Are we assembled here today? And to petition the government for a redress of grievances. Now, if you'll notice something, there's very interesting. The first thing that it mentions is religion, and the second thing that it mentions is the press, or the media, the news. We grew up in a society where the news was supposed to tell us the truth about what was going on in the country. Religion is supposed to tell us the truth about who God is and how he's being involved. So we now have a faith and a system of religion in Christianity in our church today that God is still the ultimate truth and His word does not change. But we now have gotten confused and lost in the fact that the media thinks that they can lie to us on a daily basis about everything. So it is our responsibility as people of faith to correct the lie and to stand against it and stand for the truth. So when we see something going on in the world that we know completely and irrevocably contradicts the Word of God, we say, no, that's not true, because the Bible says that this is what is true. And I am standing on the Word of God. I am not going to believe a lie from the devil. Amen? So the idea of separation of church and state, I hope I made it clear, is a complete fallacy. And we're going to discuss some of these words and what they actually mean. So this speaks, the First Amendment speaks about institutions and organizations whose responsibility it is to tell the truth. It guarantees certain protections from government control and oversight. Nowhere does it say that the two should wholly and completely be separate. It does not imply that the two should not intersect at times and have a conversation about the good of the people under their sphere of influence. The church cannot and should not dictate policy in politics to the state government, and at the same time, the state government cannot pass, enact, or dictate laws and mandates to the church about its operation. So, as I was putting this together, I remembered. Everybody remember COVID? Remember what the government said to the church? You got to close your doors. You can't gather. You can't have church. You got to shut down. How many of you are glad that we went to a church, that we attend a church that did not shut down? Because we have a mandate from heaven to stay open no matter what. And the government can't tell the church, you have to shut down. We're passing a law. You can't do that. It said it right there in the First Amendment. You cannot pass a law that affects the free exercise and me practicing my faith and my religion and going to a house of worship. So thank you, Pastor. Thank you. So we have a system of government and politics founded on Christian principles existing in an anti-Christian society. This is the struggle that we see today. The morals and the values of the word and our flesh and pride fighting against it. The great moral debate of our time is, does God really exist? And should our theology affect our politics and how we live in society? 1859, Charles Darwin wrote a book. Anybody know what the book is? They teach it in public schools today. It's the only book that they teach about science and the origins of man. It's called The Theory of Evolution and the Origin of the Species and Selected Races. Right? Paraphrasing. Up until 1859, when Charles Darwin wrote that book, the discussion about the existence of God didn't even enter into the minds of people. Every single culture, society, and country prior to that book acknowledged that there was a supreme deity that created humankind that everybody should worship. Now, some of those cultures and countries, they had many gods. So they obviously weren't the right God, right? But every single culture, going all the way back through history, everybody knew that God created everything, and God created them, and they were supposed to worship Him and serve Him and be obedient to Him. In Europe, in the Middle Ages, You were not even allowed to become a king without the approval and the king and the crowning of the Pope. The Pope decided who ran the country. So even in Europe, there was an acknowledgement of God having supreme authority and control and rule over the country. So we're going to discuss a few words here, because I said it before, our theology should affect our politics. So, does God exist? We absolutely, if we're here in this building, we absolutely 100% believe that. And this is his word that he wrote to us. So I got these definitions from, I used the Britannica dictionary. So the word theology. I'm going to read the entire definition. My lovely wife is going to put it up there. This is the abbreviated version. So this is like a snapshot. I'm basically paraphrasing, because if I had the entire definition, it would take up about 4 or 5 slides. And that was just a lot, and I didn't want to have my wife have to do that and have to, she's like trying to roll through 5 slides, right? So in a nutshell, it is the study of God, how he relates to humanity, his worldview. So how he views the world and creation, his plan for salvation, and how he intends to end the story. So theology, I'll give you the full definition. It is philosophically or intellectually or rationally thought about something. That's what philosophy means. It means to take information and think about it through your brain from the start of a thought all the way to the end of a thought. How many of you have ever been in a conversation with somebody and they lose their train of thought in the middle of what they're saying? So they have a good start, but they don't end up finishing it, and then you're left sitting there and you're like, all right, well, I guess we'll circle back around to it, right? And you leave more confused than when you started the conversation, right? So that's all philosophy means. It means to rationally and logically think about something from its start to its finish. So it is an oriented discipline of religious speculation and apologetics. That word apologetics means to know what you believe, in a nutshell, what you believe, why you believe it, and how to defend it. It is the idea that traditionally restricted because of its origins and format to Christianity, but so that it may also encompass, because of its themes, other religions, including Islam, Judaism, and Christianity, obviously. So those are the three major religions that theology encompasses: Judaism, Islam, and Christianity. The themes of theology include what I just said: God, humanity, the world, salvation, and eschatology, which is just another word for the study of the end of the times. So it's the study of God and how he relates to us and how we relate to him, how he relates to the world, how he views the world that he created, right? And his plan for salvation for the world that he created that fell from grace, and how he plans to end the story and come back and redeem us. In a nutshell, that's theology. So if you're taking notes, keep going, because we got a couple more. The next one is morality. It is the moral beliefs and practices of a culture, community, religion, or a code or system of moral rules and principles or values. It is the conceptual ideas and foundations and rational consistency of such standards as are the subject matter of philosophical discipline. So we saw philosophy over here. Or of ethics. It is also known as moral philosophy. In its contemporary usage, the term ethics is also applied to particular moral codes or systems and to the empirical study of their historical development and their social, economical, and geographical circumstances. That's a lot, right? There's a lot in that definition. Basically, simply put, It is what we believe to be right and wrong, good and bad, and how it affects our society, community, and economy. How is our everyday life and relationship impacted by our beliefs? So how is how we act out there impacted by what we believe in here and in here? That essentially is morality. Ethics is the actual acting out of it, right? So ethics is how do we act out or act upon the morality that we hold to be true. And we all have a moral code. It's found in Exodus chapter 20, the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments was so pivotal and crucial in the founding of this country that they used to actually have church services in the White House. They put it up in the halls of justice. They used to have it put it up at the entrance to schools because they understood that there was a moral code of values that came from God that we should all adhere to. And so then the ethics was how do we act upon those things? So if you'll see, there's a tie-in between theology and morality. Now we're going to tie them to the other two words. Society. The word society means a people. In general, thought of as living together in an organized communities with shared laws, traditions, and values. A large group of people who live together in an organized way, making decisions about how to do things, sharing the work that needs to be done. Simply put, it's a large group of people or a community of people that are like-minded with similar values and principles working together to reach a common goal. We are a community, but we are also part of a community out there. How many of you guys live in a neighborhood? How many of you live in the United States? Right? That is our community. Our neighborhood, our town, our city, our state, and our country is all part of one large community of a bunch of like-minded individuals, we hope, that are working together with shared and common values, morals, and ethics to reach a common goal, which is what? The betterment of the people. So now we get to the dirty word. Politics. Politics is not merely government. It doesn't just apply to the government. Politics is activities that relate to influencing the actions and policies of a government or getting and keeping power in a government. The activities of the government, members of law-making organizations or people who try to influence the way a country or a community in general is governed or ruled. We talked about the word rule, right? So politics is really the activities of a people who have decided upon the laws with which to govern and rule themselves. The laws and values are based, or the laws are based on the values set forth by the society. So the laws that the government enacts and puts into practice are, in a sense, taken from the society of the people that live there that have decided upon a particular set of law rules or morals and ethics that they then say, hey, this is what we think should be the way things should be done. So if you see that, then we understand that the way that I want to rule and to be ruled is set up by the society of the people that I live with, which we have decided upon a set of morals that we have found in the Word of God to be true. So then we say, this is what we want to lead us. Is this making sense?
Yes.
I know it's a lot. There's a lot of information. Some of these definitions are difficult and hard to understand. But I felt that the Lord was telling me this is important for us as a people to understand, as a church today, to understand that it's not, we're not voting for a candidate or a party. We are voting for the Word of God to be upheld and to be true in our country today. This is not a Republican, Democrat, left, right. This is about what does God say is right? What does He say is wrong? What does He say is good? What does He say is evil? And we say we want the good. Because the Bible says that I place before you today life and death, blessings and cursings, choose life. So if we know something is wrong and evil, why do we choose to overlook it and ignore it and say, well, that's just a political discussion. I don't want to talk about it. Because if we do, then we are essentially condoning what is evil and what God has said, do not choose it. If we know it's wrong, we must make a stand for the truth on the Word of God that says, no, I will not have that. I will not hear that. I will not allow that. I'm voting for Jesus. I wish He were on the ballot. That would be the fastest and quickest election in history. There would be no doubt. One of the reasons why I say this also is I'll share a quick story about my mother, and then we're going to get into these last points. Is my mother, and I remember this when I was a kid, but she was arrested in a church. Now, we're not going to get into the topic, but she was protesting against a specific policy that was being tried to be passed into law. And she was in a church, and the church called the police on her and said, no, you can't say that here. So when the church has gotten away from its moral code of ethics, what the Word of God says is true, then we begin to allow the devil to influence the world that we should be influencing. The Bible says that the devil, that the world is under the devil's influence. But how many of us know that as children of God, we have the ultimate authority? So it might be under his influence. So if he's doing something to influence the world for the negative, why are we not doing something to influence the world for the positive? So now we're going to discuss, well, what is my theology? So if my theology is to affect my politics, what is my theology? If my theology should influence the rules and the laws that we decide to govern us as true, what is that? And there's a lot, but we're going to go through them quickly. So be ready to take notes. What is my theology? Well, the first one is that God is just. 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So that leads me into my next thought about my theology. Well, what is my theology? Well, if God is just and He's faithful to forgive my sins, then that must mean that I am a sinner. Romans 3:23. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Romans 5:8. But God clearly shows and provides His own love for us by the fact that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So that leads me into the third thing about my theology, that Christ died for my sins. 1 John 2:2. And He, that same Jesus, is the propitiation or substitute for our sins, the atoning sacrifice that holds back the wrath of God, that would otherwise be directed at us because of our sinful nature, our worldliness, our lifestyle, and not for ours alone, but also for the sins of all believers throughout the whole world. Which leads me into the fourth thing about my theology. Christ died for the world. John 3:16 and 17. For God so loved the world. Come on, read it with me. We all know this one. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Are we seeing a train of thought about our theology and how it should affect how we live here in this world? That leads us to the fifth thing, that we are saved by grace. Ephesians 2:8, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Which the last two, number six, I am to tell the world about Jesus. Matthew 28:19. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations. Help the people to learn of me, believe in me, and obey my words, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, remaining with you perpetually, regardless of circumstance, and on every occasion, even to the end of the age. He gave us the mandate to have dominion in Genesis chapter 1. We see how to carry it out in Matthew 28. And this brings me to the final thing about my theology. He will finish what he starts. Philippians 1:6. I am convinced and confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will continue to perfect and complete it until the day of Christ Jesus and the time of his return. So my theology is about what I know about God, humanity, and his worldview. So if I relate to God and he relates to me, and he has a view of the world, then that means I should have a biblical worldview about how I look at the world. Which means that I should be wanting to influence the world for what God has said. Which means that the society and the community and the culture that I live in, I should be telling them about Jesus and being bold to speak the name of Christ. My theology should determine my morality. My morality should impact the society I live in. And my society should influence the politics and the government that rules over it. The issue is not party-based, but it is scripture-based. The Word of God is the final authority and should be used for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. We have the opportunity, a very unique opportunity in this country that not a lot of other countries have, that not a lot of countries have the opportunity and the ability and the privilege to actively participate in the governing of themselves. We have a duty. So, while this isn't about voting, election is in a couple weeks. So I want us to think that if we are planning on voting, when we go to the polls to vote, it's not about left, right. It's not about this person or that person. It's not even about the policy, necessarily, but it is about the Word of God and what does it say. And that I should use this in my direction and guidance. Because this is ultimately what has the power to change the world. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Glory to God. Glory to God. I know this wasn't necessarily your typical message, but I hope that it blessed you the way it blessed me. And let me tell you what, this was a struggle. It was a struggle because I was like, man, we're going where in church on Sunday morning? Hallelujah, Jesus. You got, whoo, boy. But praise God, because we need to know and understand the importance of His Word. So with that, I'll close, and we will go into tithes and offerings. Amen. Amen. So if you want to come on up, ushers, if you want to start the music, nice and soft in the background. So as I was studying, and then this morning, my wife was like, I need the tithe scripture. And I was like, oh, man. So I went back there, and I was like, Lord, I totally spaced the scripture on giving and on tithes and offerings. Where do we go? And He led me to two specific verses. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. It says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land. How many of us are praying that God would heal our land? So then he continues with that train of thought in a different book, but Malachi chapter 3, verse 10 and 11. It says, bring all the tithes into the storehouse that there may be food in my house. And try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such a blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. And this is the good part right here. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes. Amen. So that he will not destroy the fruit of your ground. Amen. Nor shall the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field, says the Lord of hosts. So we're praying that God would heal our land. We're praying that God would start a revival in this land. And he says, if you would just give to me. And this is one time in Scripture where he says, test me in this and see if I will bless you so much that you can't even hold it all in. And not only that, but I will heal and preserve your land and rebuke the devourer from it. So as we give this morning, you're not giving to the church. You're not giving to pastor. You're not giving to a particular denomination or faith or even Christianity. You are giving to God and saying, Lord, I need you to heal my land. And you said, God, that if I would bring all the tithes in, that you would rebuke the devourer, you would heal our land, and you would forgive me of my sins. So this isn't just about a giving. This is about a Lord, forgive me and heal what is broken. So if you're ready, and if you are excited about the forgiveness in Christ and the healing power to heal what is broken, shout amen. 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 It's time to give, Mount Zion.